Welcome to AATCM, the Emergency Medicine Channel. Today we'll be discussing a case that presented to our ER with breathing difficulty. Can you begin, sir?
Yeah.
So it was a 62-year-old obese female who was brought to our ER with complaints of generalized weakness since about 2 weeks, along with breathing difficulty since about 3 days. So our initial 10 seconds, since the patient was alert, conscious and oriented, we moved on to the primary survey. Now in the primary survey, patient's airway was patent with no pooling of secretions or hoarseness of voice or grunting seen. In the breathing wise, patient was tachypneic with respiratory rate of 28 to 30 cycles per minute, maintaining saturation of only 82% in room air. So bilaterally, her chest was adequate rise was seen with bilaterally symmetrical chest movements, but on auscultation she had minimal basal crepitations. So we started first her on supplemental oxygen while we prepared BiPAP.
Okay, you were planning to put her on NIV. Meanwhile, you started on oxygen.
Okay.
So, how many liters of oxygen through which way you have started?
Face mask we started her on, sir, at 4 liters per.
Face mask, what is the minimum to start?
4 to 6.
Mm. It should be above 5 liters. It's ideal to go with the face mask. Okay.
So in the meantime, BiPAP was arranged. Then after
what
that, we put her on
BiPAP. So early, just by seeing the patient?
Patient was had basal crepitations also, sir, plus breathing difficulty. She's had so
bilateral crepitations.
Yeah.
Okay, then we'll come back to it.
So BiPAP we started her on.
BiPAP starting, it will take at least 10 minutes. You have to get the machine, you have to fit the mask, everything. You started on oxygen. Meanwhile, you can continue your assessment.
So circulation wise, her heart rate, she was tachycardic with heart rate of 124 beats per minute, maintaining BP of 160/90 millimeter per mercury. All peripheral pulses were palpable, so 2 large IV cannulas were secured. Now, disability wise, she had full GCS score 15/15 with pupils being bilaterally reactive and symmetrical to light. Exposure wise, she was running a temperature of 101.3 degree Fahrenheit with sugars of 260 milligram per deciliter. So at this point in time, paracetamol 1 gram IV start was given in order to bring down her temperature, and Actrapid was also insulin, short-acting Actrapid of 6 international units subcutaneous stat was also given.
Start for 260 straight away, somebody is coming with breathlessness, 260 is the sugar. We'll start Actrapid.
She was diabetic also.
So
she has
so diabetic, non-diabetic, whatever be the reason, just like that you will start insulin. Is that needed? Insulin is very early that is needed in this patient.
Not so.
So before that, what all things you wanted to know before you give insulin to this patient? What is the basic investigation that you wanted at this point of time?
ABC.
No.
To see if there's any metabolic acidosis or not. So.
Before giving insulin, what will be your priority? You will be looking for what?
Any acidotic features or any dehydration fluids that. Potassium.
To be more specific, potassium. So 260 sugar straight away, no need of start sub-Q insulin also is not needed. You can just wait, you can just get the blood sugars, the blood gas analysis done. After that, you make sure that it can be a DK?
That we'll get to know after acidosis is seen on the APGs.
No, can it be a DK?
Yes, it can.
Somebody coming with breathlessness, somebody is having high sugars, it can be DK also. So do a blood gas and see, and which is a priority in diabetic ketoacidosis management? What is the priority?
Fluid replacement,
then?
Potassium,
then only insulin will come. So insulin will be the third or fourth priority only. So you need to start insulin straight away. You can just wait and watch, get the blood gas analyzed. What is the blood gas showing?
It was showing metabolic acidosis with respiratory alkalosis. So pH was 7.41. PCO2 60.5 and 37.9. So when you do the compensation by Winter's formula, PCO2 had to lie between the range of 62 to 66.
Now why are you saying it is metabolic acidosis? Why you are saying it as a metabolic acidosis? Well, what is the pH?
7.41.
So it is compensated. Whatever be the reason, it is compensated. Now you have to say what is the primary disorder, whether it is a respiratory or whether it is a metabolic.
So
what is the patient complaint?
breathing difficulty.
Seeing the patient, you have added one word in the first line, the patient is obese. So what will be the first problem that is lying down?
The respiratory problem.
So respiratory, what will be the acidosis, metabolic acidosis? What will happen to the bicarbonate?
There will be PCO2 retention.
What will happen?
Acidosis, what will happen to the bicarb? Up or low?
It will go up.
Metabolic acidosis.
Metabolic acidosis, it will go down.
What is the?
37.9.
So what is it?
So your Windows formula will come up only if the primary thing is metabolic acidosis. Okay. Here the primary thing is respiratory.
So the patient is having a respiratory acidosis, but it has compensated.
Yeah.
Okay. Now the question arises whether it is chronic or acute. It's
chronic respiratory acidosis.
Okay. Why you say it is chronic?
Because there is compensation from the kidneys. So basically, by the time kidneys compensate, it'll take a while. So
okay.
If the bicarbonate has gone up to 37.9, it means to say that the condition has been long standing.
What is the potassium?
4.2.
I am saying there is also 3.1 is the potassium. You said that from seeing the bicarbonate, you are suggesting that this patient is having primarily a respiratory acidosis, and by seeing the bicarbonate, you are telling that it will be a chronic respiratory acidosis because the kidney has started compensating from by this time. I am telling you the bicarbonate increase is not due to that. It can be due to metabolic alkalosis also. Can it be due to metabolic alkalosis also?
Yes.
So primarily what will be the problem in metabolic alkalosis? You will have associated hypokalemia. So it will be like a vicious cycle. Hypokalemia will cause metabolic alkalosis. Metabolic alkalosis will cause hypokalemia. But here there is no hypokalemia. So you cannot straight away say that by seeing the bicarbonate, it is a renal compensation that has happened for a chronic respiratory acidosis. You cannot say. And as of now, she never had any respiratory issues. She never had, only 3 days history, that's what you are telling to me right now. But being a chronic respiratory acidosis, you should have some history, some obstructive airway disease. Some, like this patient, she had probably she is an obese lady. Her BMI was around, what was the BMI?
This.
Difficult to calculate the BMI. We have to calculate the ideal body weight. Maybe it will be above 35. Whatever you have seen from the patient, it will be above 35. So what is the primary disorder here?
It is chronic respiratory acidosis.
Chronic respiratory acidosis. Compensation?
There. 37.9 is there.
So 37.
For a 10 change in PCO2, what is the correction for?
Sir, if at all it is a chronic, then for every 10 raise, and it has to raise for 4.
Mm. So 15 raises are here.
So here?
So from
what's the normal bicarb level you are going to take?
24.
24 plus 8. Right? Roughly.
Mm.
So what will be that?
So 24 plus 8 would be 32.
Yeah, what is here?
37.9.
Yeah, probably there is some metabolic alkalosis. Probably. Okay.
It will be there. There is some. So to be 100%.
He is on diuretics at all?
He is.
No, only on Tolvaptan. No, sir. Last 6%
there. She is on Tolvaptan?
Tolvaptan.
Okay. So one thing is that this ABG diagnosis, you have to be very clear. It is chronic respiratory acidosis with metabolic alkalosis. So that is your finding that you have seen from your ABG. Okay. So Windows formula only when you see metabolic acidosis. Don't use Windows formula in other situations. Okay. Fine. Continue.
So potassium, like I mentioned, was 4.2. Sodium was 137. Lactate was 1.1 and creatinine was 1.2. Now after that, ECG was taken because patient was tachycardic. ECG showed sinus tachycardia with heart rate of 126 beats per minute with left axis deviation.
What are the ECG changes you are expecting in a COPD patient?
You
know? What are the ECG findings in a COPD patient?
COPD patient will have low voltage complexes.
Okay.
If at all it is emphysematous, then there will be flat T wave seen in lead 1 and prominent.
COPD.
P permanent. Right heart failure. Mm. Which will be there.
Okay then. Well, multifocal atrial tachycardia can be seen. Can you see RBVV? RBV. LBV is less common. RBV is more common in heart failure or whatever be the right heart failure, co-pulmonary, all those cases. Okay. this patient is having a left axis deviation. Why she is having a left axis deviation? What could be the reasons for a left axis deviation?
Hypertension can cause, long-standing hypertension can cause left axis deviation. Pulmonary hypertension, that causes the
blood pressure and RV. So that can cause, that sound suits for this patient. Long-standing type 2 respiratory failure leading to a pulmonary hypertension, then leading to a right ventricular hypertrophy, all those, that suits for this patient, maybe an early. So you have to be judiciously, you should be telling this. Okay, then.
Then point of care, CBC, CRP was taken, sir. Total counts were 23,000. Platelets was just 0.3. Lymphocytes was 8.3 and neutrophils 86.6. Platelets 1,27,000. So portable chest X-ray was asked for.
Okay, now we will come back to the
hematocrit 42.5.
Okay. Now we will come back to the management part. You said you will start on BiPAP. Okay, you have asked for a BiPAP. Now, before starting BiPAP, what are the prerequisites to start?
One, level of consciousness, sir.
Most important, level of consciousness. Good. Then?
So,
what will be the level of consciousness you will say, I will not try a BiPAP?
If a patient is drowsy.
So, you have to have a mark from like this GCS, I will not ask for BiPAP. This GCS, I can ask for BiPAP, but chances of failure is high. This GCS, okay, definitely I will go for BiPAP.
From 13 downwards.
So, less than 8, definitely yes, we will never ask for a BiPAP. So, depends upon patient to patient, it might vary because some patients may be 11 or 12, the chance of failure will be there, but they might tolerate the BiPAP. It all depends upon your airway reflexes and underlying comorbidities. So, primarily, this lady is having a respiratory issue, so it's a high likely that she will tolerate a BiPAP. So, someone else with a neuromuscular dysfunction with lower GCS, you should not be preferring a BiPAP. At that time, the chance of failure is very high. So, the patient selection is the most important, like you said, consciousness then.
One, there should be like an indication for BiPAP itself.
No, like before starting BiPAP, you have asked, straight away you asked for BiPAP. Yeah. When you said low GCS, you will never ask for BiPAP. Next.
So, the patient is already a claustrophobic.
Okay, psychological
patients.
Then.
Okay.
The patient is not willing for it itself, compliance.
Okay. You are just filling the paper with lot of stuff.
Any secretions, oral secretions that are
not mixed? Aspiration it can cause, so.
Okay, then any anatomical reasons?
Deformity, facial, anatomical deformities, any facial fractures.
Anything to do with the circulation? We are dealing ABCD people.
Patient is hypotensive.
Cardiac arrest is contraindicated in massive pleural effusion and pneumothorax is contraindicated. Then hypotension because it can increase
the
intrathoracic pressure and again reduce the
venous return.
So,
what are the various interfaces you can use with BiPAP?
Interfaces.
You have the device, you have the pipe, and you have the facial interfaces. Interface. The device which you can mask.
Mask, facial mask, helmet, nasal.
So you have three, at least we can use this nasal, the full face and nose and the helmet interface.
Okay, now before selection, you're just asking for a waiver, you should be seeing all those things. You have to rule out first, most importantly, life-threatening causes. That is pneumothorax. Look for your entry, rule out a pneumothorax. Hypotension, again, it is again one of the relative contraindication. 90-60, definitely yes, you should not be putting them on a BiPAP. And low GCS. So definitely you have to understood. Once, what is HACCOR score?
That is, once the patient is on BiPAP, we calculate the score to see if there's been any improvement or deterioration of the BiPAP.
So, what are the parameters that you look into?
After 2 hours, after starting the BiPAP, we will be doing the HACCOR score, sir. We will be taking 5 parameters like respiratory rate, pH, GCS will be taken, acidosis and
PO2. Okay, so the thing is that it's a prediction of failure of your NIV. So as the GCS worsens, the predictive chance of failing an NIV is high. So So that is basically HACCP score. So you have to calculate after 2 hours and you have to predict whether there is a chance of failure or not. Okay. Now you have selected the machine. Now you have asked for an NIV. Sister has got you an NIV. So what are the different modes of NIV that you know? Different types of NIV, to be very frank.
There are three types. One is continuous positive airway pressure, that is CPAP. The second one would be a BiPAP, bi-level positive airway pressure. And then there's one more called as APAP, that is auto titrating positive airway pressure.
So APAP is a newer mode. We will not see in all the NIV modes. So which one you will ask for this patient?
Either be a CPAP or a BiPAP. So because if it always suspecting an OSA, then CPAP would be a better choice. If at all the patient has heart failure or pulmonary edema or COPD or anything of those sorts, we go for.
He just have an OSA?
No, with right heart failure.
Probably so a right heart failure. We are not very sure. Maybe we can assume that she might be having a heart failure. Some crepitations are there. So maybe a BiPAP will be an ideal choice at this point. Now, what are the parameters that you need to set in?
So, BiPAP will have two things. One is IPAP and EPAP. So, IPAP is basically a modality to improve the ventilation, which will be higher than the EPAP. EPAP is corresponding to the PEEP. So, if at all patient's ventilation is fine, we can start with the least, that is 8:4, and then titrate accordingly. But in this patient, since the patient was tachypneic and had OSA with RHE, we started with 12:6
will be an ideal thing to start with. Yeah. Then titrate according to your second ABG or patient condition, because suddenly you are increasing the pressure. 14:8 is a high pressure. Mm-hmm. The patient might not tolerate. Mm-hmm. Because once you should keep that mask and see, once, then we will understand what is the pressure that is coming out of it. You have to remember that the patient is sick and she is breathless, and at that moment some amount of claustrophobia also will be there. You are fixing the mask, the pressure air is blowing into your face, so it will be a difficult thing. So you have to slowly titrate. The thing is that you have to be with the patient. When you are initiating on NIV, the first 30 minutes you have to be with the patient. Soon you should not go and strap the face mask and all. Just keep the mask, let the patient feel it and let them tolerate it for the next 5 minutes. You can ask the staff to slowly tie it and let them be comfortable. Now, what will be the FiO2 that you need to set in, or what will be the oxygen liters that you need to give?
So, this patient is obese, so the chances of having OSA is high. So, anywhere between 88 to 92% of saturation, if she is achieving, it's good enough.
So, PO2 of around 55, we are happy. Mm-hmm. We are not much more that. So, 85, 88 saturation, we are okay with that. We don't want an above 95 sort of a thing, or above 90, 92 is not needed. Mm-hmm. Somewhere around 85, 88, we are happy with it. So, you need to titrate it accordingly. Suppose the common mistake that all does, maybe the staff nurse or maybe very junior doctors, that they does is that they think that this patient should need a saturation of around 100% and they will increase the FiO2 and oxygen flow rate. So that is, what does that do to this patient?
It will change the drive from, it will become a hypoxic, patient will be on hypoxic drive, so the
Hypoxic drive will go.
Ventilation, yeah. So the patient will stop breathing.
So the ventilation will go, again the PCO2 will start building in. You will achieve 100% saturation, and after that your second ABG, the patient will be more drowsy and your PCO2 will be above 100. So that should not never be done. So adequate training of this should be done, given to all your staff members, and nobody should be increasing unwantedly the FiO2. So our target has to be very clear. Okay. Now again, there are different modes, like timed mode, non-timed mode. So what will you select for this patient?
This timed mode.
But straight away putting into the time mode, what will happen? She's already tachypneic. So what will happen when you're putting in a timed mode? It will be difficult for her to tolerate. So maybe after some time you can go for the timed mode. Initially start with the simple modes and go to the timed mode, ST mode later. So that will be the comments, Sabrish?
No, the key thing is you being with the patient and allowing the patient breath to sync with the machine. So that might take some time. So you just don't thrust upon the patient and tie it and going will lead to beta failure. So always initially, as Krishna told, start slow, low pressures, hold it, disconnect if need be for the patient, and then allow him to sync with it. And any, what's the role of Ryan's tube in BiPAP patients?
That can cause gastric distension. So And chances of aspiration could be high, so a RILE tube.
From an ER perspective, I don't think it is a very much thing. You can just put the patient on NPO and start the patient on bypass. That's okay on an emergency basis. But if the patient is requiring long-term bypass, it's always better to put a RILE tube and keep it open while the bypass is on.
Aerophagia part can be taken. Okay, so now you have initiated on BiPAP, and after what happened to, after initiating BiPAP after 2 hours?
So we take serial ABGs to see how patients.
How frequent?
Up to 2 hours, every 2 hours or every 2 to 4 hours.
From the initial perspective, probably 2 hours is okay. So once you know the trend, then probably you can space it further.
4 hours.
No, you can use ETCO2.
ETCO2 can be used.
ETCO2 help can be taken care of, but when you have SpO2, you can come to know by your saturation. Only concern here is the carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide, you can just go through the ETCO2 plus or minus 4. You can unwantedly avoid puncturing the artery, everything you can avoid. So after 2 hours, definitely yes, you take 1 ABG. Usually, when you have had a reasonable settings, 1 hour is the recommendation, but 2 hours, that what I suggest, because it will take some time for the patient to cope up. So only 1 hour of proper NIV ventilation would have happened. And if there are any worsening, usually there will be slightly worsening or there will not be major improvement after 2 hours. We need to have some problems in your settings or in NIV. Maybe after 3-4 hours of your NIV, the patient will be fine. That's the usual thing. So by just seeing the second ABG, you should not feel like, okay, my NIV has failed, I should go for intubation. Unless and until the patient has low GCS or any other contraindication of NIV, definitely you should think of converting into or hypoxia, refractory hypoxia. You're not able to manage. Go ahead and intubate that patient.
This patient on serial ABG showed a decreasing trend in PCO2. So with the last ABG being around PCO2 having around 42.8.
Okay.
So from 60, it's come down to 42.8.
So what about ETCO2? What question I told? Always look for the matching between the ETCO2 and PCO2 at the first training. So if it is matching, you can follow up with that. There can be issues where there can be an ETCO2 with PCO2 gap or a mismatch. In those kind of scenarios, we may not be able to go with ETCO2. So at least the first thing you have to know, or how close or how
trend. The problem, if you have a normal lung, for a normal lung, this is what plus or minus 4 is okay. For this patient, it might not be a normal lung. So maybe her trend will be like some 5 to 10 difference of ETCO2, that has been her trend. So you have to, with the PCO2, you have to match the ETCO2 for each patient to patient. That's what the point has been said.
Especially with chronic pulmonary embolism, making mismatches there, the difference can be huge.
Okay, then what else? The adjunct treatment that you have started for her?
Then Foley's catheter was added to check for the to monitor urine output and bedside screening for echo. So that showed LVH with fair LV function,
okay.
LV systolic function. So from then on, we moved on to sample history.
So like this sort of OSA sort of patient.
Mm-hmm.
So are we concerned? Are we going to see some LV dysfunction?
Yeah.
Usually, no.
RV.
They will be more having a feature of diastolic dysfunction. So usually they will have more of diastolic dysfunction. So when you look for their echo function, you will always see a normal echo findings. And you have to specifically look for this diastolic dysfunction. So what is the problem in the diastolic dysfunction? What will happen to the curve?
That it will be with maintained ejection fraction.
Ejection fraction will be always be maintained. But what will happen? A sudden increase in the volume. Or sudden increase or decrease in the volume. Sudden increase in the volume, the patient will become immediately symptomatic. And we give 1 or 2 shots of furosemide. You remove that volume, maybe 100 or 200 ml of fluid is removed, the patient will be back to normal.
Mm.
So that is very common to see in this obese ladies with obstructive sleep apnea and maybe chronic hypertensive patients. So you are always, we will think of, okay, LV ejection fraction is 60%. Why is she having heart failure? You are checking her BNP. BNP is like 3000, 4000. But diastolic dysfunction, always consider that. That's the one we can miss, but we need to treat it, and adequate fluid management, everything need to be told to them.
So then we moved on to the sample history, sir.
Mm.
Sample history, signs and symptoms are she had generalized weakness since about 2 weeks, with which following this she developed breathing difficulty since about 3 days, but otherwise vomiting histories occasionally she had in the last 3-4 days. But no other complaints as such, no known drug allergies. She was on telmisartan 40 mg, silacar, that is clindamycin 10 mg, tolvaptan 30 mg and rosuvastatin 10 mg, along with clopidogrel 75 mg. This is because she was a case of old CV, dyslipidemia, hypertensive and query OSA, because She was obese also.
So how will you diagnose OSA?
Polysomnography.
You have to go for a polysomnography or the sleep study. You have to continue monitor 24 overnight. You need to see, and you need to look for the BiPAP titration also. So fine. Okay. What else you can proceed? So examination.
In event wise, basically patient presented with complaints of generalized weakness, no slowed responses. At that point in time, her sodium level was around 110, which for which she was hospitalized, corrected, and she was discharged with it. During the course of this hospital, she developed fever for about 2 days. CT scan showed subsegmental atelectasis in the middle lobe lingula and bilateral lower lobes consolidation was also there. That's about it. So she was treated with IV antibiotics of meropenem and claripid. She was suspected in view of aspiration pneumonia, treated, symptomatically discharged, and she was discharged home. Then she had developed again breathing difficulty, for which she was brought here for evaluation.
Anything positive findings rather than crepitations?
Then along with other than that, no, sir, no raised JVP, no distended neck,
okay.
Bilateral pedal pitting edema was there.
Okay.
So with this, we went ahead with lab investigations, which showed CKM, cardiac enzymes, to be little on a higher note of 3.9 and TROP-T to be 0.06. Total counts was 26,670, but procal and CRP were
negative.
So urea, RFT, LFT, all of that was fine, and asymptomatic urine.
So she was febrile, that's one thing. She was continually febrile. Total count is 26,000.
26,000, and urine routine showed features of numerous pus cells also.
UTI, okay.
So it could either be a UTI or could be an LRTI that could
add on infections.
To
okay.
This.
So what antibiotic was started for her?
She was on ceftriaxone, sir.
Okay. So how is the patient now?
Patient's improved. Like the PCO2 trend has decreased. So she is on an improving.
Okay.
So how did you get the patient off
BiPAP?
How did you get the patient off BiPAP?
Once the.
We did pay for the BiPAP. So this patient, she's having an OSA come out, she requests BiPAP at night. At least a CPAP should be kept at night. Then in the daytime, we can space the BiPAP, like 4:1, 4 hours we can keep the BiPAP, 1 hour we can give a break. Like that, we can titrate to 2:2, that is 2 hours off, 2 hours on, and then 1:4, and then we can plan something. But this patient requests nighttime BiPAP.
Basically, nocturnal, you might need to continue in this patient.
Okay. Fine. Thank you.